African heads of states have called for regional cooperation among countries in the Sahel in the fight against terrorists. They also called on Western countries to intervene in Libya to stem a flow of arms to militant groups there. The leader said this at the just concluded International Forum on Peace and Security in Africa held in Dakar. They also discussed the need to operationalize the proposed African standby force to address insecurity issues in the continent. African leaders said threats posed by violent extremist groups feeds off the absence of borders and their porous nature. The African continent is currently grappling with extremist groups like Boko Haram in Nigeria and cross-border insecurity in the Sahel region.
Today we are witnessing another phenomenon, terrorism. This scourge has no face, no nationality, and spares no country. It feeds on political and social-cultural frustrations, personal or collective identity claims, and many other factors that contribute to radicalization and extremism. Therefore, we have to fight this phenomenon with the entire required rigor at the risk of seeing all progress falling apart. This requires from our states a strong mobilization of resources for a pooling of efforts.
Une forte mobilisation des ressources et une mutualisation des efforts.
Aussi bien dans la nature des menaces.
The paradigms have changed in both the nature of the threats and their impact. This is why we also need to change the approach and method. Obviously, the conventional strategies will no longer work. We need to innovate in the method and action. I hope that by the various discussions and proposals that we'll have generated, the Dakar Forum will have contributed to the emergence of a collective consciousness about the need to forge together the lasting foundations of our common strategy in the face of common threats.
So let's take you back to Uganda, where nearly 1,000 former M23 rebels have escaped to another refugee camp in the western part of the country to avoid repatriation to the Democratic Republic of Congo. Now, Uganda last night flew over 100 rebels to the DRC. This repatriation process is aimed at preventing the reemergence of the rebel group that was defeated last year. So let's have a further discussion around that here in studio. I'm joined by Macharia Munene, a professor of international relations at the United States International University Africa here in Nairobi. He's also an author of several books on security, governance, and international affairs. Thanks for joining us, Prof.
Thank you.
So we have these allegations made by former M23 rebels, and basically they're saying the Kinshasa government is not ready to receive them back and they fear for their lives. What do you make of these allegations? Is there real cause for concern?
Well, they are cause for concern because, first of all, you have more than 1,000 people experienced fighters, troublemakers,
right,
on the loose, so to say. Mm-hmm. And it is also correct to say that the Kinshasa government has been pressing Uganda and their neighbor, can you bring these people back so that to resettle them or deal with them somehow? It is a cause for concern because it can mean renewal of some fighting. If these people retrench, mm-hmm, and then reorganize themselves, and some of their commanders, we don't know where they are exactly. Mm-hmm. All we are getting to hear is Bertrand Bismiwa, the spokesman now,
yeah,
being referred to as the chairman, saying this and this and that. Where the actual experienced fighters are is another matter, because they could be regrouping.
Mm-hmm.
And if they are not in an area that can be monitored,
right,
it could resurge forward. And then we have a volatile situation in that eastern Congo region.
Mm. Yeah. And speaking of a resurgence in violence, we've seen some attacks of late, a flare-up of violence, especially in an area they call Beni in North Kivu province.
Mm-hmm.
What could possibly be leading to this?
Well, to start with, that area is full of splinter groups, and each of them is fighting to find space for itself.
Right.
And when they see a weakness coming up, what is developing is that Kivu, northern Kivu area, is showing to be fragile again. There was a semblance of stability,
mm-hmm,
and that semblance is now being challenged. And with the increase, there are more than 25 groups all claiming to be fighting for something, freedom of this or that and that. And in fact, part of the reason the M23 got defeated properly last year was in part because they started fighting among themselves.
Right.
And right now we do not know how many of those splinter groups are splitting again. And when they split, you start having commotion and internal friction that then spreads to the other areas until one of them emerges to be the dominant force. Right now the situation is very fluid and it is not a good one.
Right. Yeah. So we've also seen quite a number of rebel groups there, like you're talking about. Yeah. We understand now the FDLR is recruiting again, mm-hmm. despite of course the UN mm-hmm. program to voluntary disarmament, mm-hmm. and we obviously have what they're calling ADF, the Allied Democratic Forces in mm-hmm. Benin, and so many other groups there. Yeah. And there's so many talks that have been held on what to do to bring lasting peace mm. and stability in the DRC. Mm. But ultimately, what do you think should be the option here?
Well, the people of the Congo have to accept
yeah.
that they need to stop fighting. They need to accept peace as a struggle.
But sometimes they will tell you a group such as FDLR is not a native group, so to speak. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So they all have to do it. Mm. Of course, you have this friction, the problem with the borders. Because you have the same people in Eastern Congo, they are the same people as in Uganda,
yeah.
and as in Rwanda and Burundi. That colonial boundary that is created new identities. Some people have refused to accept these new identities. So to tell somebody that he is Rwandese instead of a Congolese, mm. or a Congolese instead of an Ugandan, or instead of a Burundi, is still problematic in terms of acceptance. And that has yet to be figured out how to deal with it. So in dealing with this thing, we really have to address the issue of identity, mm. not only in the Congo, but in the Great Lakes region. And once that issue of identity is properly catalogued and right. Analyzed, maybe we can see the way forward. Mm-hmm. Of course, the other way is to maybe create a big state, open up,
right.
big infrastructure, because right now some is just a whole forest, and nobody can see anybody else. So make it difficult for people to hide.
All right.
Yes.
Thanks, Prof, very much for this insight. We've been speaking to Professor Macharia Munene here in studio.